Got yourself shaving, Bertie?
Very funny.
Now, I'm still relying on you, Bertie, to speak to him about the allowance.
Why can't you do it?
You know he respects you. Doesn't respect me at all. Oh, well, here goes.
Suspected of raping an 18-year-old girl.
Concern for the safety of a 12-year-old boy who's been missing for more than a day and a half without his medication. Andrew Bishop from Cates Hill has epilepsy. His parents say he was worried about going to school and crept out of the house in the early hours of Monday. He was wearing a T-shirt, shorts and slippers and was carrying his pillow.
Police and mountain rescue teams have been searching for a Staffordshire teenager who went missing after going to a rave party in the Peak District. Andrew Harrop from Stafford was last seen at a quarry near Stanton Leas in Derbyshire on Saturday.
Police search teams have spent the last 2 days scouring the land around Leas Cross Quarry for any sign of Andrew Harrop. The 19-year-old had gone with friends to a rave at the quarry on Saturday. He became separated from his friends. They called the police when they couldn't find him on Sunday morning. Volunteers from Derbyshire's mountain rescue team have joined the search. Their expertise is needed because much of the area is hazardous.
It's very thick bramble and also some quite steep cliff faces, so we are a bit concerned that maybe he has stumbled over them, and it is difficult in order to get through the bramble in order to find any way through.
Environmental campaigners who are opposed to quarrying have a camp at Stanton Leas. They've also been helping with the search.
If he'd come off the cliff, he'd have come off somewhere along there, and there isn't, or further along. We've looked everywhere, we've checked all the houses, we can't find him. I don't think he's here. I guess he's probably gone to Glastonbury.
Back home in Stafford, Andrew Harrop's mother has been phoning his friends in the hope they may have news of her son.
Okay, he stays out, but he doesn't do it often and he doesn't do it without telling me. I mean, he told me he was staying out Saturday night, he'd be back Sunday. But he isn't.
So far, the searchers have found Andrew's mobile phone, but haven't come across any other possessions. Rescue teams were out until nearly midnight last night, and they plan to continue searching until late this evening. If Andrew Harrop hasn't been found by the end of today, they'll widen the area being searched tomorrow. Liz Copper, BBC Midlands Today, Stanton Leas in the Peak District.
Thanks, Liz. Thanks for joining us. You're watching Midlands Today.
We've got plenty more lined up for you, including a bike trip and a special guest.
Hi, this is Bobby Davro. Join me later in the show and I'll be telling you all about a brand new show called Eternal Flame that's coming to Wolverhampton. What I'll be doing, lots of people like Bob Geldof and Boy George. Remember him? Preferred a cup of tea to sex. Nice to have a choice, isn't it? See you in a minute.
That was it, wasn't it?
Excellent. Good. Thank you.
But first, children with a distressing spinal deformity are benefiting from a technique pioneered by surgeons in the Midlands. The Royal Orthopaedic Hospital in Birmingham is working with the University of California to introduce the system. In the second of his series on 21st century medicine, our health correspondent Andrew Tomlinson met one of the young patients and her surgeon.
Now, let's have a look and see. How are you feeling? Are you all right?
Bethany Smith is given a pep talk by her doctor before she goes into the operating theatre. Surgery involves adjusting an elaborate metal frame attached to her spine. Bethany has scoliosis, a condition which means her back has been twisted since birth.
She just gets on, that's how she is, because she's always been like that. And we just say she's got a special back. She's got special sticks and screws in there. And she just accepts it.
There's one or two tears as Bethany's wheeled into theatre. It's the sixth time she's been through this. But the new device is really making a difference.
It allows us to start with a child whose spine is quite twisted and quite deformed, and gradually over time to straighten that. So the main advantage is that all the surgery doesn't have to be done in one go, and this makes it much safer. It also allows us, as the children grow over 5-10 years from the original surgery, it allows us to deal with problems that perhaps couldn't be foreseen when the original operation was done.
Before the invention of the so-called paediatric Isola technique, children were sometimes encased in large plaster casts, sometimes fitted with elaborate braces, but neither technique proved successful. Bethany's progress, though, has been dramatic.
This was Bethany's spine 2.5 years ago, bent to an angle of more than 60 degrees. But this is Bethany's spine now, after the paediatric Isola technique, and it's almost straight.
So far, surgeons at the Royal Orthopaedic Hospital have fitted around 30 of the devices to children from all over the UK. They're working with American doctors to perfect the technique.
60% of our children come from outside Birmingham, so we provide a regional service. And so children will come from places like Coventry or Wolverhampton or Dudley, or even further afield. Last week we had a patient from Northern Ireland come for treatment here.
After an hour's surgery, Bethany Smith is on her way to the recovery room. Within a couple of days, she'll be back home. The results of the spine straightening technique are looking good, but it'll be 10 years or so before doctors really know how well it works when the first patients reach adulthood. Andrew Tomlinson, BBC Midlands Today, Birmingham.
Now, today it was National Cycle to Work Day, although you might not have guessed it to look at the roads this morning. But perhaps the opening tomorrow of the new 5,000-mile-long National Cycle Network will encourage more people to convert to pedal power.
Yesterday, our transport correspondent Peter Plisner got on his bike and sampled the new route from the north of our region. Today, he rides from the south.
The new National Cycle Network passes within 2 miles of around a third of the UK population, and it's hoped it'll persuade thousands of people to get on their bikes. Through the Midlands, the route runs from Oxford north to Banbury before joining Warwickshire's Greenway, a disused railway line which is already popular with cyclists of all ages.
So if you had like a network to cycle wherever you want to go, it'd be a lot safer for younger people.
It's a lot nicer to cycle out in the country than in busy roads.
I've sort of stopped cycling recently, but I'm sure I'll cycle more often now.
And there's more to bikes than just BMX. Here at Pashley's in Stratford-upon-Avon, they've got the lot. With a trike and a tandem, you've got a family bike. And how about using the National Cycle Network for shopping with this more traditional bike? For more laid-back cycling, how about this reclining bike? And for those who want to use the cycle network and public transport, how about a folding bike?
As people start to think about the benefits of cycling, both for health and leisure, then hopefully they'll go into the shops and buy, and we'll benefit from that.
The route continues north through Warwickshire along the Stratford Canal towpath, where at Wilmcote you can visit Mary Arden's house, the former home of Shakespeare's mother. Its collection even includes a bicycle dating back to 1860. And after a hard day's cycling, you might fancy a rest on one of these structures made of old railway sleepers. But it's not just a seat. At the back, there's a cycle rack. Back on the network, the route travels north through Redditch and Bromsgrove before reaching the outskirts of Birmingham and the Ray Valley cycle path. Once in the city, new traffic lights allow cyclists to cross busy roads, and several new cycle paths have been constructed. John Grimshaw, the network's creator, hopes it'll make a lasting contribution to cycling in the UK.
Well, I would like it to be the place which people look back at and say, this is where we learn to cycle again.
The new National Cycle Network opens tomorrow in Birmingham Centenary Square. I want to ride it where I
like. And if that's made you keen, and I'm sure it has, you can find out more information about the new cycle network on CFAX page 172.
And now we return to tonight's top story, where a man understood to have been part of a gang that carried out an armed post office raid has been found dead from stab wounds in the getaway car. Police say the postmaster at Wolverley near Kidderminster picked up a knife used in the shop and lashed out with it several times. Well, joining us now is our Home Affairs correspondent, Peter Wilson. Peter, what do we know about what actually happened today? Well, clearly we're not hearing from Peter Wilson at the moment. We'll try and get back to him for more details a little later on. But right now, let me just ask you, what do yuppies, the Rubik's Cube and Wham all have in common. Their age, they were all products of the 80s, a decade about to be celebrated in Wolverhampton with the world premiere of a new musical. It'll star comedian Bobby Davro and pop star Sonia, and with plenty of hit music at the time, it'll recapture the spirit of the decade.
Singing sensation Sonia and entertainer Bobby Davro were at the Grand Theatre in Wolverhampton today to launch an 80s revival.
Yeah, do you want to stalk the stand?
No, I'm all right.
It's unbelievable. You've got turnips in his wife front down here, look.
Drop
a key ring. We do all the short gags, eh?
The not-so-tall himself comedian is getting ready for the world premiere of Eternal Flame, a musical recapturing the days of the Yuppie, which will eventually go to the West End and America. It tells the story of a man forced to account for his sins on Earth before he's allowed into heaven.
Basically, the character dies and has to account for how he was in the 80s, which takes into account all those sort of yuppies, the mobile phone, he becomes successful financially, share dealings, all those sort of things, and he meets along the way Essex girls.
I play lots of different characters. I play Bud Geldof, do you remember him? I need your money now. And so I might be having a bath for a couple of weeks. And what else am I playing? I'll be playing a bit of Boy George. I don't give that away. It sounds a bit like Julian Cleary when I do Boy George. Without you, I have spoken.
Before the stars arrived in town, local youngsters were given the opportunity to audition for a part. These three were all successful.
I think the others and me were very good.
As well as being punctuated with classic hits from the likes of Wham, the musical also features a real-life 80s star.
Up 13 to number 15, Sonia, Only Fools Never Fall in Love.
I do like the Bonnie Tyler stuff. I used to like it.
Could you give us a quick burst?
Once upon a time I was falling in love. Now I'm only falling apart. There's nothing I can say. A total eclipse of the heart.
That was great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Bob. And as you gather, Bob isn't very tall. In fact, Bobby Davro also said to him, mind your head on the coffee table, young man.
Charming as ever. Now, if you think that water feature you've been thinking about sounds like very hard work, imagine planning 20 acres of gardens.
If you can't, you could always take the chance to enjoy somebody else's efforts. The gardens of an historic Herefordshire estate will be open to the public for the first time this weekend, and John Yates went to see them.
Hampton Court, a typically British estate, and the realisation of an American dream. Robert and Judy Van Campen, the couple from Michigan who fell in love with it.
I can remember my mom calling home. She said, oh, it's going really well. We're finding our way around. In fact, we bought a castle. I said, oh, for goodness sakes, Mother, couldn't you buy a set of china like everybody else?
The house is ancient, but the 20-acre garden's so modern, they're not yet finished.
How long will it take? It will take... We've got many more ideas and lots of things in the pipeline, so... it'll be a few years. I mean, perhaps not on this scale, but there's lots of ideas to come.
Created from the remnants of the court's Victorian gardens, there's a yew maze which will amuse and amaze you, with a three-storey folly in the centre, if you can get there. And a secret underground tunnel which leads to a hermit grotto overlooking a sunken garden. Robert Van Campen, the man with the vision, died late last year.
He loved this place because it was a special project for his wife and his daughters, and he was especially looking forward to the festival, and he'll be greatly missed this weekend.
The restored Hampton Court gardens and grounds open to the public on Saturday. John Yates, BBC Midlands Today, Herefordshire.
Thanks, John. Now we return, we hope, to tonight's top story, where a man understood to be part of a gang that carried out an armed post office raid has been found dead from stab wounds in the getaway car. Police are saying that the postmaster at Wolverley near Kidderminster picked up a knife that's used in the shop and lashed out with it several times. Well, hopefully joining us now is our Home Affairs correspondent, Peter Wilson. Peter, if you're hearing me now, what do we know about what happened today?
Well, it's an extraordinary story, Nick, and yes, I can hear you now. Apologies for the gremlins that we've been having. This extraordinary story began at 10:15 this morning when a lone raider entered the post office at Wolverley, probably the quietest time of the day. There, the 50-year-old postmaster Richard Watkins faced the man who brought out a sawn-off shotgun. The man demanded money. And Mr. Watkins fought back. Tonight, the police are describing his actions as being very brave. He received a blow to the head with the butt of the shotgun, but he picked up what is described as a lock knife, a knife that he uses to untie the string around the newspapers, and lunged at the man, who then, clutching his chest, staggered out of the post office. He was aided by two other men who bundled him into a blue Sierra car, which then sped off at speed. Now, that car was then discovered in another part of the Wall Heath area of the West Midlands, and a man who had been stabbed was found dead in that car.
Bearing in mind events recently in other parts of the country where a man who challenged burglars and actually killed one was charged, I think people will be dying to know, will this postmaster face charges?
Well, you're obviously referring to the Tony Martin case, the Norfolk farmer, and that was a very different matter to this one. Tonight, West Mercia police are describing Mr. Watkins as a brave man. They're not yet questioning him about what had happened because of the trauma involved, but certainly they are treating him as a victim of crime, not as a perpetrator.
Just very briefly, Peter, we get the impression that the police know who they're looking for, is that right?
Well, the forensic teams are still tonight at the post office. They're gathering clues. There's a lot of information, obviously, at the scene there and also at the car where the body was found. And we do know that that car had been stolen earlier.
Peter Wilson, thank you.
Let's take a look at the weather now. Here's Shefali.
Thank you very much, Sue. Well, today was obviously the release valve for pressure and temperatures. We had lower pressure and also lower temperatures. Yesterday we had highs about 33 Celsius. Today we've had highs of 21 or 22. And the cooler weather continues overnight. But to begin with, it's going to be dry. Bit of broken cloud, but we have got a front coming in towards midnight, and that's going to introduce some light patchy rain that's going to spread away eastwards. But tonight, once the cloud breaks by about dawn and the rain dies out, we'll see temperatures drop to about 11 or 12 Celsius. In fact, that's true for most of the night, so it's going to be much easier to sleep in, not as close or sticky, and the winds are going to be fairly breezy there at about 14 miles per hour from the southwest. But moving on to tomorrow morning, with those cloud breaks developing at about dawn, we should see some good spells of sunshine tomorrow morning. But we have got showers developing there, as you can see, in the west of the region, and those are going to become quite scattered during the afternoon, although a good few dry and sunny spells in between. Temperatures, incidentally, tomorrow up to 19 or 20 Celsius, but it is going to be a lot fresher with those winds at about 20 miles per hour from the southwest. That's it.
Thanks a lot, Shefali. Now, what's got 4 feet and 15 hands? How about the biggest donkey in Britain, allegedly?
The owner from Shropshire believes Birkenhead is a record breaker. We sent Lindsay Doyle to check out one very, very big donkey.
Welcome to Woodhouse Farm, where I've heard there's something very strange going on. Apparently, they've got a donkey which is the size of a horse. Surely not. Meet Jimmy, an average-sized donkey. Then meet Birkenhead, the King Kong of the donkey world.
And I've never seen anything like it. I've never seen anything like it. I've never seen anything like it in my life.
We found her up in Cumbria. Last week we went to Appleby Horse Fair, and while we were there we were walking down a lane and saw what we thought was three large mules in the distance. But as we got closer, what we realised we were seeing was three enormous donkeys. When we finally did get to them, we were just amazed at the size.
Lined up for Birkenhead, who stands at 15 hands, is a rather handsome boyfriend, in the hope they may produce a rather large mule. How did the stallion react to her?
Well, he looked a little bit strange, as if to say, what's this little bit of rough you've put in the field? But then when he realised she was a female, he did accept her and put her into the herd.
But what kind of a name is Birkenhead for a donkey?
Well, I say, just look at her head and that will tell you everything.
Birkenhead's immediate future is sorted, but what about her long-term prospects?
Any plans to take her to Blackpool Beach or whatever and make a fortune?
Well, at least you could put one fat lady on and you wouldn't feel guilty, would you?
What a fate. Lindsay Doyle, BBC Midlands Today, Shropshire.
As long as he's not in our back four tonight against Romania, that's all I say. Now look at tonight's main news. A man thought to have been part of a gang that carried
out...
We
need to find out if he has...